Well, good morning from the United States, everyone. My name is Kiel Majewski. I work with Together We Remember, and I'm coming to you from Kickapoo, Peoria, Sauk, and Meskwaki, Ho-Chunk, Miami, and Siouxland that is now presently called Madison, Wisconsin. And I want to thank our last session participants from the National Holocaust Center and Museum in the UK and the Kigali Genocide Memorial Center in Rwanda. Really, really inspiring program. Thank you. That's what this vigil is all about. And we're going to shift now to the subject of Auschwitz, that most notorious of concentration camps and killing centers during the Holocaust. And specifically, we're going to focus on a new exhibition called Auschwitz, Not Long Ago, Not Far Away. It's the largest and most comprehensive traveling exhibition ever produced about Auschwitz, and it is currently installed at the Museum of Jewish Heritage in New York City. In addition to my role with Together We Remember, I'm also an advisor to the Florence and Lawrence Spungen Family Foundation, which has one of the largest private collections of Holocaust documents and artifacts in the world. And the Spungen Collection has on loan a few dozen pieces. Robert Young probably knows exactly how many, in the Auschwitz exhibit, which is how I met Luis and Robert Young. So this hour, we're going to be joined by two very special people, Luis Ferreiro and Robert Jan Van Pelt. Luis is coming to us from San Sebastian in Spain, where he is the CEO of Musealia, an exhibition company that created the unprecedented new Auschwitz exhibit. In 2009, Luis conceived and led the project to create this exhibition about Auschwitz and its historical repercussions, which is an unprecedented collaboration between Musealia and the Auschwitz-Birkenau State Museum, which displays a large collection of original objects. So for more than 20 years, Luis has been able to develop his passion for the humanities and museums, creating traveling exhibitions that have been visited by millions of people all over the world. And that's just Luis. Our other panelist today is Robert Jan Van Pelt, who's a Dutch author, architectural historian, professor at the University of Waterloo in Canada, and a Holocaust scholar. He's one of the world's leading experts on Auschwitz, and he regularly speaks on Holocaust-related topics through which he's come to address Holocaust denial. He was an expert witness in Deborah Lipstadt's successful defense in the civil libel suit brought against her by David Irving. And he's also the chief curator of the exhibition Auschwitz, Not Long Ago, Not Far Away. So Luis and Robert are going to conduct something of an informal virtual tour this morning with us by describing the challenges and choices made in representing Auschwitz, as well as their personal journeys from the exhibit's conception to installation. So Luis and Robert, welcome, and thank you for joining us in this around the clock, around the globe vigil.
Thank you very much, Kiel. And it's I was just saying before that it's really a pleasure to have to do it with Robert, because of course he was a key person in the whole story of making the exhibition. And it's the first time actually that we do kind of a lecture together to explain and to go over the process. So it's really a privilege to be in the same panel with him.
So Luis, you start with the movie.
Yes, so actually, since we don't know how many people have been to the exhibition or has seen it, but since we're going to talk about it, we thought that the best way to start was actually to show our viewers what are we going to talk about, and this is the exhibition. So it's a video where I think it's the nearest thing to probably visiting the exhibition. So I'm just going to share now the video. Let's see. No, I just have to do it again because I need to share also the sound. So if everything is going well, you should be seeing now the presentation. I'm gonna press play and watch out with the sound. It might be a little bit loud, but I'm going to try to control it also. So here we go.
jüdischen Rasse in Europa.
So, if you allow me, Kiel, I was just, as I was going over the movie, as I was watching it, of course, this movie was recorded in Madrid in the first stop of the exhibition. And I'm going to stop sharing this so that Robert actually has been able to prepare a few slides with pictures of the exhibition in New York. And while Robert uploads his slides, I want to ask Robert actually a question that I get a lot, and probably him too. And is, of course, the exhibit is sort of the same, but at the same time is different from Madrid to New York. Do you, Robert, get a lot the question of which one do you prefer, which one do you like more, and how do you respond to that?
Yes, let me just, I just have to first say I prepared something slightly different than what you said. We're making of the exhibit. They're very different. The Madrid setting was absolutely amazing. It was also the first, you know, like your firstborn. I mean, it was the discovery of at a certain moment see everything come together for the first time in Madrid. Certainly, I think that in New York we were able to in some way we had a greater palette of artifacts, because the collaboration with the Museum of Jewish Heritage in New York brought a whole new collection into the exhibition and some very, very powerful artifacts there. So in some way, I like both of them for different reasons. I thought the setting in New York, the space which you saw in the movie here in Madrid was absolutely splendid. It was a monumental space, an old water tank. New York, it's more tight. It's 2/3 of the size, but of course the location of the Museum of Jewish Heritage in New York, in view of the Statue of Liberty in Ellis Island, incredibly powerful and symbolic, given also the significance of our exhibition for questions of human rights, refugee policies, and so on. So I love both of them.
And pretty much like me then. And one thing that I remember you were also specifically worried about, and we spent a lot of time in thinking, of course, in New York, we have three different floors. And I remember that one of the issues that you were really focusing was in where do we make the cut? So that in theory, something that we were uncertain about, which is cutting the exhibition into three different spaces and different floors, was done in the right way. And it didn't go against the narrative of the exhibit. And I have to say that the more I think about it, probably, and the more I am in New York and I am in the exhibition, I think that in a way, we were able to turn an apparently disadvantage into actually a strong point, because I think it actually helps when you're in New York to know that there are three different floors, and that once you finish the first one, you have, even if it's just 1 minute to go from the first to the second floor by the escalators or by the lift, it helps you also to take a little pause. So I don't know if you have the same feeling of actually how something that was something worrying for us was turned into something quite positive in the way we tell the story.
As you are a Real Madrid fan and I'm an Ajax fan, of course, Johan Cruyff, who then in the end, of course, went to Barca. I mean, he became the trainer of Barcelona. But he always used to say, when I was young and he was young, that every disadvantage has its advantage. Yeah, every elk nadel has some voordeel. And of course, the disadvantage that we had in New York, where we had a much tighter space and we had three floors, which means that the decision of where to cut the exhibition, where to move from one piece to the other, becomes absolutely an important strategic decision. But we made the right one, I think. In Madrid, we had this single line. There was no interruption, which of course has also its great attractions when you create an exhibition. In any case, what I thought I would do right now is, and actually there are more slides, I will see how far we come. Interrupt me when you think you've had enough. But I just wanted to go to review a few issues in making an exhibition. And this was also part of our discussions, and you can weigh in. Of course, in some way, there's nothing that can compare and compete with a actual visit to Auschwitz. And here we have an image of the Arbeit macht frei gate in the Stammlager in Auschwitz I. But what you also see is that when you go there in the summer or the fall, there are a lot of people, and in some way, it is one of the most popular tourist sites in Europe. I mean, more than 2 million people come there every year. It's incredibly successful, but it also means that, to quote Johan Cruyff, in some way, the success stands in sometimes in the way of having a concentrated experience of the place itself, where you feel that you're, you know, more like sitting around a campfire, this idea of storytelling, where you need to get into a bubble. And in Auschwitz, in some ways, enormously large site. It's actually two sites, but you negotiate it in one day. But of course, there are all these other things going on. And what we try to do is actually create that bubble that you have when you sit around a campfire and listen to a story. Now, when you came to me, and this was, of course, one of the reasons that I was very eager to work with you, you said that you did not want to do something with what most traveling Holocaust exhibitions do, and that is to create an exhibition without artifacts. Very good exhibition, the Deadly Medicine exhibition that was created by the U.S. Holocaust Museum, but no artifacts. So they become somewhat sterile environments. And so you said what I want to do is I want to have an exhibition with artifacts, which means that we need to go to people who have the artifacts. And of course, I'm a little bit of a collector. It's my family history. I have the artifacts, but then of course, the Spongen Foundation, where Kiel advises, they gave us a lot of artifacts. But the largest collection was, of course, at the Auschwitz-Birkenau State Museum, which became our partner. We also decided that we wanted to give the full history of Auschwitz in its context, and that context involves the creation of a station there. It was a very important railway junction long before the camp was established. It was about telling about the German invasion of Poland in 1939 and the annexation of Auschwitz. The town of Oswiecim became the town of Auschwitz into the German Reich. It became a part of the German Reich. It became a focus of German settlement. Then the history of the camp, first of the Stammlager, a very violent concentration camp, mostly for Polish resistors who were abused and killed there. A story about how in 1941 an enormous amount of money comes into that camp when right next to it, IG Farben, the largest company in Europe, creates a rubber factory, a synthetic rubber factory. And this investment changes really the course of history of the concentration camp itself, which moves from being a peripheral camp in the German concentration camp system to be one of the central camps. then the invasion of the Soviet Union in June 1941, which brings an enormous amount, millions and millions of Soviet POWs into German hands, and the SS wants to use them as slave labor. So they create right next to the original concentration camp a new concentration camp called Auschwitz-Birkenau, originally meant for Soviet POWs. But then after a short time having functioned exclusively as a Soviet POW camp, it becomes a destination for Jews from all over Europe. And this then becomes the place where, in some way, the key place of the Holocaust, where arriving transports undergo selection, and those who are not deemed to be useful for work will be murdered. And these, of course, mostly are older people, younger people, mothers and children, in specially built crematoria. And the total victim number of the Jews and then a smaller group of Roma Sinti who were murdered in these gas chambers, around a million. Now, as we set out to find the artifacts, I'm going to now focus on the artifacts.
One philosophical maybe question, Robert. How difficult is it to actually explain or tell the story of Auschwitz when you are in Auschwitz versus explaining the story of Auschwitz when you are outside of the site?
Now, there are two issues. The first thing, the first problem is a simple issue of crowding. Yeah, that if you go through the exhibition itself, quite often it's quite crowded, which means that the guides have incredibly good guides. They're very well prepared, but they work with microphones, and everyone has a little earphone. So everyone, basically, you're following the guide, but you know, you're negotiating all of the other people, and the guides have to move on through these rather kind of tight spaces. This is one of the problems. You cannot stand, you cannot be somewhere for, let's say, 10 minutes and 15 minutes when you're inside and focus on a single artifact. And so this is the first problem. The second problem is that when you create a story, there's a natural order to the story with a beginning, a middle, and an end. But when you are actually going through a site, a very large site, then in some way the site has certain kind of, imposes a certain journey in which something you really would like to start to tell right at the beginning can only be told at the middle or the end, because it's only at that time that you actually reach that point. So in some way, to create a story from scratch and to design an exhibition that follows a storyline is in that sense much easier. And so in some way, we had it easy compared to the guides in Auschwitz, I would say. Yeah, because we could start from scratch, yes, you know, with a blank page. But I'm just showing here, you know, the hunt for artifacts. You are here in the Auschwitz Museum in the warehouse looking at artifacts. These are stretchers. One of the stretchers we are actually using to represent basically the fate of people who basically are at a certain moment lose all of their, and who become ill, the so-called Musulmen, and then who die in the camp. We represent that through a stretcher. You know, there are all of these artifacts that were brought by the deportees, like in this case, shaving brushes, all beautifully labeled. You know, they have thousands of them, each one individually recorded. And then, of course, when we have the artifacts, we need to basically decide how we're going to use it. So I'm just walking very quickly through some of the choices you have as curators. So the artifacts that you use historically and artifacts that are used symbolically. Historically, this is a memoir written in 1945 by a survivor of Auschwitz who's in a DP camp in Germany. And his native tongue is Yiddish, but he has to learn German and English. So his teacher, his language teacher, says, write your experiences in Auschwitz, and we see that in the right column, in Yiddish, and then translate it in German and English. So we have here one of the earliest memoirs of Auschwitz written in three languages, yeah? But it is basically a tool for this person to make a new beginning. A fantastic document, fantastic historical document. But then sometimes you have to use artifacts symbolically, which means you need to give immediately an impression on the visitor, like right here at the entrance of the exhibition, an enormous wheel set of a German freight locomotive that actually is that is supposed to touch you immediately emotionally, which you do not have to explain. The earlier artifact you have to provide an explanation for. This in some way tells a story without an explanation. So this is a symbolic artifact. Or this gas mask from Auschwitz is both symbolic artifact, because you get the gas mask is kind of a horrifying caricature of a human face, but at the same time it's historical because it was used by the SS when they introduced the gas into the gas chambers. So two realities come together, historical and symbolic. In a good exhibition, you need to have artifacts that confirm expectations and artifacts that survive. So when you have an Auschwitz exhibition, everyone expects to see one of the suitcases that the deportees brought to Auschwitz. That's what you see in Auschwitz, very big exhibition, displays of these suitcases with the names of the deportees on it. So this is something you expect, but this is something that surprises. This is actually the score of a Mozart symphony. And of course, Mozart, we talk about peace, we talk about beauty, we talk about the best that humanity has produced, but it has the stamp on it of the Auschwitz Inmate Orchestra, which of course is, you know, when the moment you realize that, you said, what does it have to do with each other? Which is exactly, you know, how could this have happened in a civilized country like Germany? There are unique artifacts and artifacts that we call the extras. That is, we have a lot of them. It's a little bit like in a play. Unique artifact would be a drawing made by a young prisoner while he was in the camp. It shows basically a roll call in the women's camp. So unique that this thing survived. Yeah? But then we have hundreds and hundreds of buttons that basically were taken of the clothing of the deportees. But the buttons themselves, they're like the extras, but they actually become very powerful at a certain moment in the sequence of the presentation. You need to always balance these things against each other. There are artifacts that directly relate to Auschwitz and artifacts that indirectly relate to Auschwitz. For example, this is a examination table that was used for medical experiments, or we assume that, but it comes from the Auschwitz Museum. So it's quite a horrifying thing. You can also sense in the way it's displaced, in some way the position of the body on this thing. But then this is a tallit, it's a prayer shawl owned by a man who was born in the town of Oswiecim, so the town where the camp was created, before the camp was there. And then he, when he's a bar mitzvah at 13 years old, he is given this prayer shawl. That means his entry into manhood. And then he moves to Belgium. He makes a life in Belgium. We see him and his wife at the back. Solomon Kreiser is his name. And then in 1943, he's deported back to Auschwitz to be murdered there. But his prayer shawl, he is able to give before his deportation to his daughters who are in hiding. And that's how the prayer shawl survives. So it is a very personal story, but also somewhere indirectly related to the camp. Sometimes we have lucky finds. Major lucky find was an original German freight car of the type used in deportations, and it's dated 1940. You can see that on the wheel cap. Yeah. Big ones and small ones. Again, you need to create a balance. So we have an original Auschwitz barrack, which we found together, you know, in the garden of a man in the little town of Monowitz, very close to Auschwitz, which was then restored and becomes not only an artifact in the exhibition, becomes an environment of the artifacts. Here we are in Madrid. And then at a certain moment, the smallest artifacts are dreidels, toys for children found in a mass grave. Yeah. And so again, it is that contrast. You know, here we have to focus. Here you have to really get very close to the artifact to actually realize what it is.
And may I just point two things, yeah. Robert? One, because I saw the barrack and I think it's very interesting. I remember very well the first time we were there and you were dressed exactly with that hat, which reminded me of Indiana Jones. And it was very interesting how you went there and you tried to certify and make a decision whether we could use it or not. And I remember also to explain that there's it has been a very long process, and there were so many ideas coming in. And right there at that moment, I remember we sat down a few meters away from what we see in the picture, and you just started to draw in on the ground a potential idea of how to display the barrack that we finally didn't do, but it was, I thought it was great. And it was the concept of inside out, to have the different sides of the barrack in a way that it would make you feel almost as if you were in an exhibition, and then to the left and to the right, or in front of you or behind you, you would see like different walls of barracks. And it was never used, but I thought at that moment, and I still remember, I thought like, it's a fantastic idea of how to turn from one artifact to give to fill in a whole space. So I remember that, and also
of course when you go to Yad Vashem, I mean Yad Vashem, we just had the candle lighting just in the last program, at the end of the last program, and of course in Yad Vashem there is this children's memorial, and there's only one candle, yeah, but the one candle is reflected in mirrors, and so it's an infinite number of candles.
Absolutely.
So, you know, what you try to do always is get in some way the maximum bang for your buck, or from your barrack. That's the whole idea. This was only half a barrack, and it was when we got it in a very bad state. And you know, I mean, you buy it for very little money from this lovely gentleman there who had, his parents had received it in 1945 to make a new beginning after they had been deported from their farm, and their farm had been destroyed by the Germans. And then, of course, you know, restoration is, you know, I think it's still
painful. Robert Young, that's where I'd like to jump in here for a second. And, you know, because you're an architect, probably you just casually mentioned it's only half a barrack. And yet Luis and Musealia team are largely responsible for transportation and care of half of a barrack and moving it from Poland to Madrid and then New York. So Luis, maybe you could say a few words about the type of support structure necessary to care for such a huge, mostly borrowed collection of artifacts.
I mean, the first thing that I have to say is that, of course, as Robert Jan was saying, is that sometimes the easy part of an artifact is just finding the artifact. And then the most complex issue is to actually be able to display it. And from the moment that you saw the first picture of the barrack standing where it was until this moment in Madrid, there were many years and many costs that, of course, are complex to explain. But the conservation of this piece was extremely expensive and delicate, and to know exactly how to display it. And also, I believe it's actually declared as a national treasure from Poland. So it's not like you can just buy it from somebody and take it out of Poland that easily. We had the museum, the Auschwitz-Birkenau State Museum, involved helping with the paperwork, so that actually we could use it in our exhibition. And our agreement is that after the exhibition finishes its tour, it will go back to Oswincem, to the Auschwitz Museum, and they will somehow use it and display it. But I think it's very interesting that whenever we go to any museum or any exhibition and we see just one single artifact, where it's a button or it's a big barrack or half a barrack, the amount of work, time, effort, logistics, insurances, conservators thinking the way to display it so that the light doesn't hurt, the way the system to display it, historians deciding if we have to display it and at which part of the exhibition. So, and this is only one big artifact, but there are 700 in the exhibition. Yeah. So it's actually an amazing task by so many people involved. And the other thing I wanted to say, I might say something that comes after in the slides, but we did something interesting in Madrid, which was asking people what do they remember of the exhibition. And I think 80% of the visitors mentioned artifacts which were emotionally, like the red shoe, like the shoe with the sock, like a ring, like a letter, something personal. So that, of course, are emotional artifacts that anchor the visitor to the narrative, to the story that you're telling them. But then we did ask also the visitors, what have you learned? And then they didn't refer to the emotional artifacts. They referred to other kind of artifacts, which are, of course, more complex to deal with. So I think the intellectual artifacts help to explain the story behind the emotional ones, and the way they are assembled in the exhibition, and the rhythm they have versus emotional intellectual, it's also something very interesting, and maybe it's explained afterwards.
Yeah, now this is this, I mean, by the way, this barrack, of course, is very interesting because we had to put it up in one way, and then the fire marshal came and forced us to take it down because I think we missed 5 centimeters. So we had 2 inches in width. And so the whole thing had to be rebuilt again inside the structure. But yeah, so this, of course, is, you know, we're right now in the middle of this pandemic. We all have gone online. Our lives are now online. But of course, one of the things that we are reminded of is Zoom can only do that much. You know, it doesn't replace being really together in the same space. And the same thing is that you realize that, you know, I can do an online presentation of this exhibition. I can tell the story in lectures, but to actually be able to touch, in this case, this barrack, this is actually an artifact you can touch. We didn't put it in a glass case. It's in that sense quite unique. It gives a very special relationship with reality. It's an other way through touch to actually, and by being able to walk around a thing and see it from all kinds of different perspectives, gives you a very different relationship to actually the story you try to tell. So this was, I think, Luis's brilliant initial thing. This is going to be artifact based, yeah? Which of course is very difficult because it becomes very expensive. Any case, another thing which is very important, sometimes there are artifacts that have a story, come with a story, but there are other artifacts that seem to be mute and you have to in some way pull the story out of it. So for example, this is a box made by a prisoner named Bronislav Cech. He was a wood carver. He comes from the Tatra Mountains where wood carving is very, very a trade, a local tradition. Here you see he was a famous skier, so this is his signature. So Czech, you see his name there. He was an Olympic skier actually in the early 1930-32 or something like that. And we know exactly about the story of this prisoner. Here we have him as a skier in one Polish national skiing champion. And so we know exactly what happened to him, how, when this box was created, which SS men commissioned it, and so on. But then you have here, right at the beginning, a symbolic artifact. It is a shoe of a deportee, and we don't know what happened to this person. But, you know, you can ask, why would a person who's going on an unknown destination with a backpack, you know, in the middle of a war, take a shoe like that with her? You know, and this is a fancy shoe. So it means that this person believed that there was going to be a life at the end of the journey. You know, that she would be able to use this shoe. So we can start to pull out a story from the shoe. And one of our curators, Paul Sammons, who is a Holocaust educator from England, he is a master in doing that, you know. And then we have the audio tour that in some way moves you through the motions of this analysis. Also, sometimes you have to fill gaps. You have historical artifacts, but sometimes you need to have things that are produced for the exhibition because you need to basically show something and you don't have an artifact. So this is a cooking pot from Birkenau, from one of the kitchens. This is where the soup for the prisoners was prepared. But you want to show a crematorium, of course, the ruins of the crematoria in Auschwitz. We cannot bring them to the exhibition, so we make a model of it. And we have many models in the exhibition. There are artifacts that are used conventionally. That is, that the artifact suggests a story and we immediately basically say, okay, this is the story, and then where we take some risks. So conventionally, this is from the Spongen collection. This is a postcard sent from Auschwitz. Prisoners were asked on arrival to send postcards back home, say, we have arrived, everything is fine, wish you were here. Part of a deception operation. So very straightforward, it's a lie, this postcard, but it is, we know exactly the story and every visitor immediately gets it. But when we try to represent the deportation itself, that is, people herded into cattle cars being sent from Westerbork in the Netherlands or from Drancy in France to Auschwitz, how do you represent that? That's difficult. But the Auschwitz Museum has a large collection of thermos bottles. And of course, these thermos bottles would have been taken by people on their journey. So by showing the thermos bottles and in the back, some postcards that were thrown, original postcards that were thrown out of the trains, which we got from the Westerbork Museum, we suggest the idea of a journey. Yeah? Facsimiles. What is the role of a facsimile? I mean, basically, the basic claim is that all artifacts are originals, but sometimes it's impossible to get an original, because this is a you see a picture of a woman and a man. This is a woman with her boyfriend. She is in Theresienstadt. A boyfriend gives her, before he is deported, a little ring with the date of in there. And then she's deported to Auschwitz, smuggles the ring into Auschwitz under her tongue, risking her life to do so. She is still alive and she still has this ring, but we wanted it for the exhibition, but it's so valuable to her that she doesn't want to lend it to us. She says, I cannot be separated from this artifact. So we decided in this case that we have a facsimile made. And in some way, the fact that it's a facsimile because she doesn't want to lend us the ring actually in some way reinforces the meaning of the story. How important. She risked her life in 1942 to keep this ring. Ironic artifacts. This is a rope that was actually created by my father-in-law, who was a prisoner in Auschwitz. I never met him. This was made in 45 after he was liberated. He started as a tailor in a DP camp, and he finds a bale of SS uniform material, and he creates himself a house robe after having been imprisoned by the SS for many, many years as a slave laborer, after having lost all his family in other camps. But he makes out of SS uniform material a house robe, which of course means that you're at home. Yeah, he hadn't had any house robe while he was in the camps. Yeah, so he now in some way integrates the story of his suffering into his story of survival. Heartbreaking artifacts. The shoe with the sock found in an undressing room. So the boy's shoe comes there, mother tells him in the undressing room, put your sock in your shoe because then you don't lose it. It's still there when you come back. And you feel that moment of the boy doing that. He's been well brought up little boy. And then, of course, they're murdered. And it tells the story also of the deception, the idea that there will be an after the shower. And then, of course, we have many, many other issues. You know, how do you create an environment for an exhibition? You know, how do you use photos? This is the photo of the arrival in Auschwitz. But we need to create an environment. Here we are in the New York exhibition, and then we create wallpaper out of this. You have a sense that you're in that situation. Well, the photo is to the right. Texts, there's a lot of explanation. So you see here, and we call it an top line text in red, explains what the room is. You see captions under the photos. You see quotes on the wall. All of different, you know, through our text and through the original language and the observations by survivors or others, we try to tell the story. Graphics. We already saw a graphic in the movie, you know, showing the scope of the operation of bringing people to Auschwitz. Graphics to show the layout, in this case, of the Stammlager, the original camp. Graphics with information about numbers, comparative statistics, and so on. And then very important, and that's where I would like to probably leave it, rhythm. You know, when you build up an exhibition, you need to create memory, you need to create also anticipation. And for example, shoes are very important in our exhibition. We start with a shoe, a symbolic shoe, already talked about, you know, try to imagine the person who had worn that shoe before her deportation, who decided to take the shoe with her when she was deported. Yeah. Then a shoe of a person who's able in 1938-39 to reach safety, a Jewish refugee child in South America. Then the boots of the SS man on the rampe at the selection. How do you represent selection? You know, the deportees facing the doctor who says left or right. Life or death, whatever life means in concentration camp. And so we decided then to take a pair of boots, which the Auschwitz Museum, they have two pairs of boots, they lent us one. Yeah. And so the visitor walks up to the boots and faces the boots. And there we have a quote then of a young deportee who survived the selection because he was used for medical experiments. And she said, you know, she remembered the boots. And always the deportees talk about the shining boots of the SS men. So they're very important in our exhibition. And then finally, the shoe of that little boy in our display, in our exhibition of what happens in the gas chambers and the crematoria. And this is where I would like to end it, because then we add testimony, we add many other things. But I think at this moment I've shown enough of some of the issues that that I think are, you know, important in our exhibition. And maybe we can continue the discussion. We have another 15 minutes to maybe review some of the various issues I brought up, or other ones that might be of interest.
Sure. Well, all that you just talked about, Robert Jan, and the artifacts that you showed, huge range of artifacts, huge story to tell, and in some way you still have to wrap it all up into a certain plot line or narrative and give a name to it. And so the exhibition is named Auschwitz, Not Long Ago, Not Far Away. And it brings in the whole question of, what is the ethos of this exhibit? What is the proper relationship to this sacred, untouchable, ungraspable symbol of Auschwitz to our present day? And how do we talk about that in relation to what we see in the news, and how can the exhibit inform that? Not to make this a political conversation, in fact, just the opposite, because in some ways, Auschwitz should be above politicization, and yet you are creating this exhibit in such a polarized environment. So, Luis, maybe you could start out talking about how you promote and brand and all these things that are part of this major production, an exhibit like Auschwitz with so much risk involved, and you as a person of an unusual background for this field, perhaps.
Yeah, I mean, I just as I was seeing the pictures of Robert of the exhibition in New York, I think that as the same it happened in Madrid. I think that, of course, an exhibition is such a complex thing, because even if you have a great narrative, even if you have great artifacts, even if the production itself, that is the display cases, the way that they are, the quality of the vinyls, of the lighting, all of that needs to be at the same level of the story that you tell. So I was just watching the pictures, and I think also the production, of course, is something that helps a lot in keeping the quality of any experience in a museum. In regards to your question, I think that it's of course, yes. And the reason why actually the exhibition could happen was because I think we were able, first of all, to reach Robert. And because we had already been in touch with the Auschwitz-Birkenau State Museum, and I think very reasonably they just decided that they always kept telling us no. And it's just because, of course, we didn't come from a background of Holocaust institutions or organizations, and we were a private company doing exhibitions. And I think that the key moment for the project was also when Robert, and through Robert, our other curators came in, and then the team that we were presenting the museum were people that they knew, they respected, they considered to be friends, and that they understood were the right people to work with. So from a perspective of a company, then at the same time that you are creating the exhibition, that is the content, and you're doing a production plan, and you're trying to find museums that want to host the exhibition. Now, of course, it's sort of easy to say, many people, I think Robert also can testify to this, ask us, how is it possible that this was not done before? And I don't really have an answer to that, but I can only say that it has been many years, and it has been incredibly difficult to put everything together. And of course, now we all think it's obvious, and that it's, you have a lot of visitors in Madrid, a lot of visitors in New York, but nobody knew really. And we spoke a lot with Robert about, do you think people are going to come or not? Would there be interest? And we always felt like, that there was going to be interest. And at least we always felt this was a story worth telling. But I know we have only a few minutes, and maybe there are questions from viewers, but I think of course, then we also work in the graphic line of the exhibition, in how to, in the social media, in the cultural program, in lectures, in schools, groups, in everything. So it's a lot, it's a whole universe around an exhibition, and it's a very complex thing to do.
Maybe I could add a little bit, because, Kiel's question was, your question was quite specific on the political thing. Now, you know, one of the things is Luis started in 2009, I joined in 2013. Of course, 2016 came in between. we didn't set out to basically create an exhibition that was going to be political, explicitly political, that was going to have a little finger to Mr. Orban or, you know, whoever, and telling you, you know, this is, you have to learn from this and change your behavior. This is, I'm a historian. I'm not a, for me, it's very important to get the facts right, to tell the story, let's call it, in the right way. I mean, my background, as you made clear right at the beginning, started in the 1980s studying the architecture of Auschwitz. This is my architecture background. But then I got involved in Holocaust, the fight against Holocaust denial. And I was part of a movie that Errol Morris made, and then I was part of this trial. So for me, the politics of this thing is to actually to try to tell the truth, to try to give a fair representation that is a proportioned representation of something that is inherently completely disproportional. I mean, there is no right way to tell the story of Auschwitz, because in some way it's beyond telling, as many survivors have said. You know, this is not a story that can actually be told, but to have a fair attempt at it. And so we certainly have people who come through this exit this exhibition, and they say that they feel motivated to be involved in one or other civic society action. When you come out of this exhibition in New York, you see right outside there the Statue of Liberty, and you happen to come out just as another decision has been made to limit immigration of refugees into the United States, it's difficult not to come to some kind of conclusion when in this exhibition you have seen the story with original artifacts of the St. Louis ship full of Jewish refugees that was refused entry, they were refused entry in the United States in 1939. The ship was sent back to Europe with all the refugees, and some 200 are murdered in the Holocaust, some of them ending up in Auschwitz. So, I mean, you know, an intelligent person who has gone through the exhibition, who has seen the relationship, studied the relationship of this refugee ship that was refused entry into the United States, to disembark in the United States, then the relationship to Auschwitz, and then contemporary political decisions, will make, I think, what I would call a proper conclusion. But I'm a citizen of Canada. I'm not a citizen of the United States. I don't vote in the United States in this case, or for that matter, in Spain. And so, politically, I'm engaged in Canada, but not in your country. So all I can do is try to tell with my colleagues and friends the story as well as we can.
I think he gave the key, that we present the facts, that we tell the story, and people, we leave it up to people to make their own connections and their own conclusions. And this is also something that is very important. And of course, people will feel connected to one or the other story. And we've heard many people coming out of the exhibition in Madrid, and they were talking about political issues happening in Spain. And now we are in New York, and of course, people make other kind of connections. But I think we basically try to tell the story and then let it up for people to make their own judgment of our own days.
Very well, thank you. And so we have maybe two more minutes before we need to transition into the next session, which is rather technically complicated. So maybe just a final closing question from our colleague Tali Nates, who has asked on Facebook. She's coming from South Africa. What is the future of the exhibition? How long will it be in New York? What is the plan after New York?
I wish any of us could answer that.
What is the future at all? Is there a future?
The exhibit was planned to be closing this summer, and of course this has happened, so we are trying to we are speaking to the museum. There was also other cities coming after New York. We have to, so we have to speak to a lot of people and see exactly how this can be arranged. But at this time, unfortunately, it's really impossible to say, because nobody really knows exactly when the exhibition will be allowed to reopen. What we can say is that, of course, at one point we will visit other countries and other cities. And I think it would be fantastic if we have the chance in the future, in the next years, to go to as many different countries as possible, as many different continents as possible. Asia, Africa, I think it would be South Africa, of course, would be a great country to go to and go back to Spain. But if they stay tuned to the Museum of Jewish Heritage social media and our own channels like Facebook and Twitter, as soon as there are news about what is going to happen exactly, we will make them available.
Just to add to that, that I think in principle we have a 7 year plus 3 year agreement with our lenders, so that basically we are now in the third year. So basically we have another 7 years of all the artifacts without any problem. So the so basically of another 7 years of life in this exhibition, assume that this world will get back to normal.
We certainly hope so, for lots of different reasons. So, gentlemen, thank you very much for joining us. Thank you for your monumental effort in creating this exhibit. And thank you for the very transparent look inside the thought process of bringing this exhibit to life. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Gil.
Thank you. Bye.